Render, what's up? Excited, yes, yes.
Let it bang, bang. Let it bang, bang. Till his brains hang and his mama sang.
Wait, is that deck to load up? All right, oh, there we go.
And them choppers sang and the choir sang.
Oh, perfect. All right, deck showing. Excellent, excellent. All right, well, everybody, my name is Banjo Obayomi. I'm a developer advocate at AWS. My goal is to excite everybody who want to build things with the same excitement as I have building things. So hopefully this talk gets you excited about generative AI. I'm sure you've all seen generative AI, ChatGPT, all these cool things, generating images. Basically using machine learning based on human data to actually create something. So it's really just how can we embed our knowledge so a machine can also utilize that knowledge to create applications. For this talk, I'm going to kind of go through a history of how we got to generative AI, language models, text to image, prompt engineering, and show off some cool projects I've been working on. As a builder, I love to build around and try some cool things, so hopefully it inspires you to also build and explore and see what's possible, and then where do we go from here? But first, let's start about word embeddings. So a word embedding, you can think of it as a graph, two-dimensional, where we have a bunch of different words. So, for example, dog and cat. These are pretty similar to each other as we know them as animals. So if they appeared on such a graph, they will be clustered close together what this notion of an animal is. And something like a car will be completely separate away, a vehicle. That's in a completely different domain than when we think of a dog and cat. A bus would be close to a car. Simple, you know, think of that classic vehicle, vehicles over there, animals over here. And we kind of extrapolate this out to much of other things, so traffic, driver, person, you know, we have this whole aspect of where different words fall on a graph. And this is what you think of a word embedding, like turning text into numerical numbers that can be plotted on a graph. And this is how we kind of start up making a language model. We have a way to take text and turn it into a numerical output that a model can understand. Models work on numbers. We need to have a way to embed those actual texts into a way that a model can realize that. And this allows us to do something called like word to vec, which is basically taking a word and making a vector, or a list of points that we can put on the line. And this allows us to pass the natural language processing, so text summarization, question answering, sentiment analysis, speech language understanding. If you use languages like SPACY or NLTK and Python, these are kind of the bedrock things of developing natural language processing. So this allows us to do next word prediction. So very simple. We have that graph. What would come next to lazy if we want to predict something? So maybe something like a lazy person. But if we have some more memory, so this is kind of like the first instance called pro neural network. It added a dimension of what are the other words in this sentence. So box jumps over the lazy. What's the next word that comes after that? Rabbit. So, this person was not chosen this time. Rabbit was kind of the next thing that. But it doesn't have the full context of the sentence. So, this was kind of the first step of language model warp prediction. And then a new method called transformers came out around 2017. This was really kind of the jump starting of how we got to generative AI today. It had a way of calling self-attention where it was able to take context from an entire sentence, and so a model can predict the next word based on thing that happened way prior to the sentence, which locally close to the actual word. So we get back to the quick brown frog jumped over the lazy dog. So that's kind of the full sentence, and this is a very popular sentence because it's very good for typing and it has all the letters. So this is, and then a model can go on and generate that next set of text. Previously, we just wanted to predict the next word, now we can predict the next several words. And this is where we call large language model. So this kind of the basis, using that transformer architecture to understand the entire context of a sentence and be able to predict the next couple words after that. So large language models have been growing. BERT is one of the first ones with 3.45 million parameters, and a parameter is just a way to represent knowledge in a model and have a numerical representation to understand what word could come out next. And then GPT-2 came out with 1.5 billion parameters, GPT-3, 175 million, 176, so models are getting bigger, more knowledge is embedded, and more tasks can be done. And we call these type of models foundation models. So foundation models is really what's powering these amazing generative AI applications today, and it's filled with lots of word embeddings, language that's piled into it so we can do all these cool applications. Amazon Code Whisperer is one of these type of foundation models. If you have a coding, you need a help, you write a comment, and it's something like create a model, create an SV bucket, whatever. It'll generate the code for you so you don't have to be looking through Stack Overflow or looking through there. So it's another way to update developer productivity. As a builder, I don't like when we're looking through things. I want to be writing code or having something code generate for me. So tools like Amazon Code Whisperer will create when you're starting to build out new ideas or just updating. So code generation, that's one type of application for generative AI. There's text generation, as you see so many different examples. Game design, who's a gamer here? Because I love video games. Yes. Game design is very cool, so you've probably seen some like NPCs that can talk based on context, generating entire worlds. So I'm very excited to see how generative AI can be applied to different game design, industrial design, 3D printing, like so many use cases. Drug design research, folding proteins, image generation. There's possibilities are endless. Like there's so many applications that can be embedded with generative AI. Really excited to see what y'all are gonna be building. So we think of text-to-image, a very popular one. It kind of combines those, the language models and then image models to create them together so we can understand text and then map that to an embedding state of where images are. A popular model for this is Stable Diffusion. So one great idea is being able to take your own images and then feed it to a model. So in this example, we have Marigold the puppy. Very nice, cute dog. If you pass that many images into a Stable Diffusion model, you can then actually like type text, like a photo of Marigold, a puppy as street art. The picture doesn't exist, but a model is able to understand kind of that instance of the puppy and then put it in a new type of instance. And you can say like Marigold at the 8-bit art, and so on. So let's talk about how Stable Diffusion works. When Stable Diffusion gets an image, it randomly starts to add noise to the original image. And then it does that several different iterations. Then it starts going backwards from that. So you have all this static going around, and then, so that's when you say the model to transform to something else. It's able to understand, okay, how did I get to this Marigold the puppy, and how can I recreate that? How can I add other things to that? So Stable Diffusion really understands kind of that idea of putting in the text and the image and then working backward from that. So another example, Marigold the puppy at a space station. So we've been seeing all these cool prompts, so I want to get into like what exactly prompt engineering is. Prompt engineering is basically instructing a model to do something for you. So saying, I'm a journalist, I want to write this, write a blog post about this, and it's going to start generating text. But I have to say, it's prompting as an iterative development. If you ever see these Twitter threads saying, this is the best perfect prompt, I ignore those. Prompting is very iterative. There's not one thing that's always going to work. You have to kind of get feedback from that. So I like to start with an idea. So for example, get information about a keyboard from Amazon, about reviews, then summarize the following Amazon review for the keyboard, that's the prompt, and get that result back. The model generates a summary, but it doesn't really focus on the main points. And then I have to analyze, okay, I need the prompt to be more specific. I need to understand what's going on. So it's not really like a one-shot type of idea. This is a thing you're gonna be doing multiple times to iterate to find what's good for your use case. So the idea, prompt, result, analyze, workflow is going on. So some examples to be more specific is bad, just like summarize the following text. You wanna like say, please provide a clear and concise summary of the text below. So clear and specific instructions instruct the models to do much better of understanding the context of what developers need than saying, ensuring that you read the entire passage and understand the main point before writing the summary. So specifying the task and encouraging regioning for the model, having a model be able to read the entire sentence, the whole passage before providing results gives it time to think. And then saying, use the format summary or make this in JSON allows a delimited and structured output. When building applications, you're gonna wanna return something maybe in a JSON format and you need to have something to capture that very easily. So specifying the format, the structure of any type of prompt will allow you to utilize that in other applications. So now the cool things I've built, kind of give you some history, and now I wanna show what is possible to kind of inspire y'all to start building things as well. So first thing, I wrote an entire book. So I'm sure everybody. Woo! So I'm sure everybody has a notepad with a bunch of notes, like saying, I'm gonna write a book one day. And that was me. I had a Notion dashboard, all these notes. I'm gonna write a book about how to take action and do something decisive. But then you look at that blank page, I'm like, I don't wanna actually write this. But generally, that kind of entirely changed. So I was able to kind of take my notes, put it into prompts, start editing it, getting some results back, doing my ideas, and then able to take all that text, edit it a little bit, and then put it on Amazon. You can actually publish self-directly on yourself. It's a very easy process. There's software to do that. It was an amazing process to kind of just do that. So if you've always wanted to write a book, like, nothing's stopping you now, so go for that. So I'm really excited to see who's gonna be the next best-selling author using kind of these generative AI. Oh, okay, right here. Got her book. another thing, the chatbot. So I think this is the number one use case people ask me about when they're talking about generative AI. I have a bunch of PDF documents, I have a bunch of this. How can I chat with my data? One, we talked about word embeddings as a way to actually take those documents and then translate that into an embedding database. So there are a lot of cool embedding databases that can take all the text you have, and then when you respond to a prompt, you say, hey, can you base your answer based on the text that I've generated from this PDF or this text, and then use that as the context. One of the big things people worry about is hallucinations, and like, if it says something wrong? By using kind of this way to take your embedded text and then using that as a prefect of the answer, use this what we call retrieval augmented generation. So the answers are generated based on the context you have. So chatbots, getting text is really a big use case for generative AI right now. And another cool thing I did, I made a ChatGPT plugin called ChatAWS, which allows you to actually deploy resources into an AWS account all through chat. So you don't need to use the CLI, don't need to use the console. You just say like, hey, use the chat AWS plugin to generate a Lambda function that generates a random number between 1 and 3,000. The model will actually write the code, show you how to test the code, even show you how to test the code in JavaScript, HTML. And from there, I can say like, okay, I actually want to make a website that I'm going to use my Lambda function to actually call that function. And then the plugin is able to go ahead, understand that context, make an index.html file, upload that to an S3 bucket, and then bam, it's calling all that. So generating code, generating a live website that people can access right away, don't have to touch the CLI console immediately. So imagine what people can do if you can build applications all through chat. Like, just really excited to see what people are able to do with this type of technology. So where do we go from here? That's the big thing. Models are getting bigger and more sophisticated. Newer things are coming out. Every day or week, there's a new paper, a new model coming out. It's just a really exciting time. I mean, I haven't stayed up to like 2 a.m. coding just for fun that recently, but now it's like every day, like something cool to try out. So it's a very exciting time of new, bigger models coming out. Many developers here, we're going to be leveraging foundation models on prompt engineering. Not everyone's going to train their entire new model from scratch. Most developers are going to be leveraging these foundation models and leveraging prompts to help them solve their use cases. So those are probably the two big things that I would encourage developers to really dive into and learn about. Training costs and sustainability is going to come into focus. I mean, so playing bigger models are coming out. There are going to be big companies that want to train their own models. There are some hardware specified for training those models. Amazon has one, AWS Trainium, which is built for training kind of these large language models. And it also comes into inference cost, so actually making a prediction. There are also custom chips Amazon's working on, AWS Inference. Really excited to see what customers are able to build using kind of this stack. This is how we kind of think of this generative AI stack. Amazon Bedrock's a new service that's coming out that's going to have you access to a bunch of different foundation models for customers to try out. We have the Trainium and Inference chips for people that want to train their own models or have inference. And then Amazon Code Whisperer as far as builders that want to actually write code and have generative responses, so it'll help us be more efficient when we're building. So Bedrock, I don't know when exactly it's coming out. My guess will probably be a couple months, but excited to see. A couple of different foundation models are there. We talked about Stability AI, Stable Diffusion, Anthropic, AE12 Labs. Amazon's also making their own foundation model called Amazon Titan. So I'm really excited to play and get my hands on that when it's released. And right now, there are things you can do if you want to start building today. Amazon SageMaker Studio Lab is free. Don't need a credit card. You can just get there. It spins up a Jupyter notebook for you to play around and start testing things out. Amazon SageMaker Jumpstart actually has foundation models you can play with today. Stable Diffusion is there, Flan T5, a bunch of different foundation models, and it's in a Jupyter notebook environment, so it can get ready to start writing code. And then also the Amazon SageMaker foundation model also allows you to deploy that without having to go to a Jupyter notebook. So if you just want an endpoint and have a foundation model, that's also available. So many different ways for customers to just get in there, start building, and trying things out. So I hope all of you learned something. You're really excited to start building. I've left a QR code of a bunch of resources if you really want to dive deep. There's also a survey there, so to let me know how you did, how you're excited about, and can't wait to see what y'all build.